Dear students, your attention to invited to be lecture number 4 on the subject of atomic physics. SEM, fourth model of the atom. Lecture plan. First, Thomson's model. Second, Rutherford's model. Third, the stability of the nuclear atom, atomic spectra, Bohr's postulates. In 1910, experimental evidence had been accumulated which showed that atoms contain electrons. Example Grettir, scattering of X-rays by atoms, photoelectric effect, etc. These experiments also provided an estimate of that the number of electrons in an atom. They found it to be roughly equal to A divided 2, where A is the chemical atomic weight of the atom in question. Since atoms are normally neutral, they must also contain positive charge equal in magnitude to the negative charge carried by their normal complement of electrons. Thus, a neutral atom has a negative charge minus Z multiplied E, where minus E is the electron charge, and also a positive charge on the same magnitude. That the mass of an electron is very small compared to the mass of the even the lightest atom implies that most of the mass of the atom must be associated with the positive charge. These considerations naturally led to the question of the distribution of the positive and negative charges within the atom. J.J. Thomson proposed a tentative description or model of an atom according to which the negatively charged electrons were located within a continuous distribution of positive charge. The positive charge distribution was assumed to be spherical in shape with a radius of the known order of magnitude of the radius of an atom 10^-10 meter. This value can be obtained from the density of a typical solid, its atomic weight, and Avogadro's number. Owing to the mutual repulsion, the electrons would be uniformly distributed through the sphere of a positive charge. Figure 4.1 illustrates this plum pudding model of the atom. In an atom in its lowest possible energy state, the electrons will be fixed in their equilibrium positions. In excited atoms, example Grettir, atoms in a material and higher temperature, the electrons would vibrate about their equilibrium positions. Since classical electromagnetic theory predicts that an accelerated charge body such as vibrating electron emits electromagnetic radiation, it was possible to understand qualitatively the emission of such radiation by excited atoms on the basis of Thomson's model. Quantitative agreement with experimentally observed spectra was lacking, however. Examples 4.1a. Assume that there is one electron of charge minus E inside a spherical region of uniform positive charge density rho, a Thomson hydrogen atom. Show that its motion, if it has kinetic energy, can be simple harmonic oscillation about the center of the sphere. Let the electron be displaced to a distance from the center with less than radius of the sphere. From Gauss' law, we know that we can calculate the force on it by using Coulomb's law. F equals minus 1 divided 4 multiplied P multiplied epsilon sub 0 multiplied opens brackets 4 divided 3 multiplied P multiplied R cubed multiplied rho closes brackets multiplied E divided R square A square equals minus rho multiplied E multiplied A divided 3 multiplied E epsilon sub 0, where 4 divided 3 multiplied P multiplied A square rho multiplied rho is the net positive charge in a sphere of radius A. Hence we can write F equals minus K multiplied A, where the constant K equals rho multiplied E divided 3 multiplied epsilon sub 0. If the electron at its feet free with no initial velocity, this force will produce simple harmonic motions along a diameter of the sphere seen as a voice directed towards to the center and has a strength which is proportional to the displacement from the center. B. Let the total positive charge have the magnitude of one electron charge so that the atom has not charge, and let it be distributed over a sphere of radius R equals 1 multiplied 10 minus 10 power meter. Find the force constant K and the frequency of the motion of the electron. We have rho equals E divided 4 divided 3 multiplied P multiplied R cube. So that K equals, as a result, it is equal to 2.3 multiplied 10 to second power multiplied 10 to second power neutron to meter to minute. The frequency of the simple harmonic motion is then nu equals 2.5 multiplied 10 to 15 power second in second to minus 1 power. Since in analogy to radiation emitted by electrons oscillated of the antenna, the radiation emitted by the atom will have the same frequency. It will correspond to a wavelength lambda equals C divided nu equals 1200 angstrom in the far ultraviolet portion of the electromagnetic spectrum. It is easy to show that an electron moving in a stable circular orbit of any radius inside the Thomson atom resolves at the same frequency, and so it will radiate at this frequency also. Of course, a different assumed radius of the sphere of the positive charge will give a different frequency. But the fact that a Thomson-Hedringer atom has only one characteristic emission frequency conflicts with the very large number of the different frequencies observed in the spectrum of Hedringer. Conclusive proof of the inadequacy of the Thomson model was obtained in 1911 by Ernst Rutherford, a former student of Thomson's, from the analysis of the experiments on the scattering of alpha particles by atoms. Rutherford's analysis showed that instead of being spread throughout the atom, the positive charge is concentrated in the very small region or nucleus at the center of the atom. This was one of the most important developments in atomic physics and was the foundation of the subject of nuclear physics. Rutherford had already been awarded the Nobel Prize in 1908 for his investigations in the regard of the decay of elements and the chemistry of radioactive substances. Any research in the elements was the considered chemistry. Rutherford already knew particles to be doubly ionized helium atoms. It has helium atoms with two electrons removed, emitted spontaneously from several radioactive materials in higher speed. In figure 2.4.2, we show a typical arrangement that he and his colleagues used the study to scattering of particles on passing through thin foils of various substances. The radioactive resources emit particles which are collimated into a narrow parallel beam by a pair of diaphragms. The parallel beam is incident upon a foil of substance, usually a metal. The foil is so that the particles pass completely through with only a small decrease in speed. In traversing the foil, however, each particle experiences many small deflections due to the Coulomb force acting between its charge and the positive and negative charge of the atoms on the foil. Figure 4.2, arrangement of an alpha particle scattering experiment. Since the deflection of an alpha particle in passing through a single atom depends on the details of its trajectory through the atom, the net deflection in passing through the entire foil will be different for different alpha particles in the beam. As a result, the beam emerges from the foil not as a parallel beam but as a divergent beam. A quantitative measure of its divergence is found by the measuring the number of alpha particles scattered into each angular range, theta to theta plus d theta. The alpha particle detector constituted a layer of the crystalline compound zincum S and the microscope. The crystal zincum S has the usual property of producing a small flash of light when struck by an alpha particle. If observed with a microscope, the flash due to the incidence of a single alpha particle can be distinguished. In the experiment, an observer counts the number of light flashes produced per unit time as a function of the angular position of the detector. Let n represent the number of the atoms that deflected in the particle in its passage through the foil. If theta represents the angle of deflection in passing through one atom as in figure 4.3, and theta is the net deflection is passing through all atoms on its trajectory through the foil, the statistical theory shows that theta average square in square to 1/2 power equals n 1/2 power square multiplied theta average square to 1/2 power. Figure 4.3 and a particle passing through a Thomson model atom. The angle theta specifies the deflection of alpha particles. Here, average theta square to 1/2 square power in the root mean square net deflection or scattering angle, and the theta average square to 1/2 square power the root mean square scattering angle in a deflection from the single atom. The factor from a single atom n 1/2 power square comes from the randomness of the deflection. If all deflections were the same deflection, clearly we would obtain n instead of n 1/2 power square. More generally, statistical theory gives the following angular distribution on the scattered particles. N function from theta multiplied by theta equals 2 multiplied I multiplied theta divided average theta square multiplied E to minus theta square divided average square divide average square multiplied d theta, where n function of theta multiplied by theta is the number of the alphas scattered with the angular range theta to theta plus the theta, and I is the number of alphas passing through the foil. Because electrons have a very small mass compared to the particle, they can in any case produce only small alpha particle deflections. And because the positive charge is distributed over all the volume of the air approximately equals 10 to minus 10 power meter radius. Thomson atom, it cannot provide a Coulomb repulsion intense enough to produce a large deflection of the alpha particle. Indeed, using Thomson's model, we find that the deflection caused by one atom is theta less or equals than 10 to minus 4 power rad. This result and 4.2 equations comprise the alpha particle scattering predictions of the Thomson model of the atom. Rutherford and his group tested these predictions. Example 4.2a. In a typical experiment, Geiger and Marston, 1909, alpha particles were scattered by a gold foil 10 to minus 6 power meter thick. The average scattering angle was found to be average theta square to 1/2 power approximately equals 1 degrees approximately equals 2 multiplied 10 to minus 2 rad. Calculate average square to 1/2 power. The number of atoms traversed by alpha particle is approximately equal to the thickness of the foil divided by the diameter of the atom. Hence, n approximately equal 10 to minus 6 power meter divided 10 to minus 10 meter equals 10 to 4 power. The average deflection angle in traversing a single atom then from 4.1 is average theta square to 1/2 power approximately equals 2 multiplied 10 to minus 4 rad. Notice this disagreement with the Thomson atom estimate theta less than 10 to minus 4 rad. B. More than 99% of the particles were scattered at angles less than 3 degrees. The measurement using 1 degree for theta were agreement with 4.2 for n function of theta multiplied the theta for angles theta in this range, but the angular distribution of the small number of particles scattered at larger angles was marked at the agreement with 4.2. It was found, for example, that the fraction of alphas scattered at angles greater than 90 degrees and function from theta greater or less 90 degrees divided I was about 10 to minus 4 power. What does 4.2 predict? We have n function from theta less 90 degrees divided I equals, as a result, it's equal to 10 to minus 3500. A strikingly different result than the experiment value of 10 to minus 4 power. In general, the number of scattered particles, alpha particles, was observed to be very much larger than the predicted number for all scattering angles greater than a few degrees. The existence of a small but non-zero probability for scattering of large angles would not be explained at all of the terms of the Thomson model of atom, which basically involves small angle scattering from many atoms. To scientists accustomed to thinking in terms of this model, it came as a great surprise that some alpha particles were deflected through very large angles up to 180 degrees. In Rutherford's words, it was quite the most incredible event that ever happened to me in my life. It was as incredible as if you fired a 15-inch shell at a piece of tissue paper and it came back and hit you. Experiments using foils of various thickness showed that the number of large angle scattering was proportional to n, the number of atoms traversed by the alpha particle. This is just the dependence of n that would arise if there were a small probability what is the particle would be scattered through a large angle in traversing a single atom. That cannot happen in Thomson's model of the atom. And this led Rutherford in 1911 to propose a new model. In Rutherford's model of the structure of the atom, all the positive charge of the atom and consequently essentially all its mass are assumed to be concentrated in a small region in the center called the nucleus. If the dimensions of the nucleus are small and a particle passing very near, it can be scattered by a strong Coulomb repulsion through a large angle in the traversal of the single atom. If instead of using R prime equals 10 to minus 10 power meter for the radius of the positive charge distribution of the Thomson's atom, which leads to a maximum deflection angle theta approximately equals to 10 to minus 4 rad, we ask that the radius R prime of the nucleus should be to obtain theta approximately equal 1 rad. Say we find R prime equal 10 to minus 14 meter. This, as we shall see, turns out to be a good estimate of the radius of the atomic nucleus. Rutherford made a detailed calculation of the angular distribution of the expected for the scattering of alpha particles from atoms of the type proposed in this model. The calculation was concerned only with scattering of angles greater than several degrees. Hence, scattering due to the atomic electrons can be ignored. The scattering is then due to the repulsive Coulomb force acting between the positively charged alpha particle and the positively charged nucleus. Further, the calculation considered only the scattering from heavy atoms to permit the assumption that the calculation considered only the scattering from heavy atoms. The mass of the nucleus is so large compared to that of the alpha particle that the nucleus does not recoil appreciably, remains fixed in space during our scattering process. It was also assumed that the alpha particle does not actually penetrate the nuclear region, so that the particle and the nucleus, both assumed to be spherical, act like point charges as far as the Coulomb force is concerned. We shall later that all the assumptions are quite valid except for the scattering of alpha particles from the light nuclear, and we can correct for the finite nuclear mass in such cases. The calculations finally uses non-relativistic mechanics since V divided C approximately equal 1 divided 20. Figure 4.4 illustrates the scattering of alpha particle of charges plus Z multiplied E and mass M is passing near a nucleus of charge plus Z multiplied E. The nucleus is fixed at the origin of the coordinate system. When the particle is very far from the nucleus, the Coulomb force on it is negligible so that the particle approaches the nucleus along a straight line with constant speed v. After the scattering, the particle will move off finally along a straight line again with constant speed v prime. The position of the particle relative to the nucleus is specified by the radial coordinate r and the polar angle phi, with the latter measured from an axis drawn parallel to the initial trajectory line. The perpendicular distance from that axis to the line of initial motion is called the impact parameter, specified by b. The scattering angle theta is just the angle between the axis and the line drawn through the origin parallel to the line of the final motion. The perpendicular distance between these two lines is b prime. Example 4.3 shows that v equals v prime and b equals b prime. The force acting on the particle, being a Coulomb force, is allows in the radial direction. Hence, the angular momentum of the particle about the origin has a constant value L. Specifically, then the initial angular momentum is equal to the final angular momentum O. M multiplied V multiplied B equals M multiplied V prime multiplied B prime equals L. Of course, the kinetic energy of the particle does not remain constant during the scattering, but the initial kinetic energy must be equal to the final kinetic energy, since the nucleus is assumed to remain stationary. Thus, 1 divided 2 multiplied m multiplied v square equals 1 divided 2 multiplied m multiplied v prime square. Therefore, v equals v prime, and so from the previous equation, b equals b prime as drawn in figure 4.4. By a straightforward calculation of classical mechanics using the repulsive Coulomb force, open bracket 1 divided 4 multiplied p multiplied epsilon sub 0, closed bracket, open bracket z divided z multiplied z multiplied z multiplied e square divided r square, closed bracket. We can obtain the following equation for the trajectory of the alpha particle. 1 divided r equals 1 divided b sinus phi plus d divided 2 b square open bracket cosinus phi minus 1 closed bracket. The equation of a hyperbola in polar coordinates. Here d is the constant defined by d equals 1 divided 4 multiplied p multiplied epsilon sub 0 multiplied z multiplied e square divided m multiplied v square divided 2. It is the convenient parameter equal to the distance of the closest approach to the nucleus in a head-on collision, b equals 0, since d is the distance at which the potential energy is equal to the initial kinetic energy. Simply equate the two and solve for d. At this point, the particle would come to a stop and the reverse in direction of motion. The scattering angle theta follows from 4.3 equation by finding the value of phi as r tends to infinity and setting theta equals p minus phi. In this way, we find cotangens theta divided 2 equals 2 multiplied b divided d. Example 4.4. Evaluate r, the distance of the closest approach of the particle in the center of the nucleus, the origin in figure 4.4. The radial coordinate r will equal r when the polar angle is phi equal p minus theta. Evaluating 4.3 for this angle, we get 1 divided r equals, as a result, is equal to 1 divided b sinus open square p minus theta divided to closes bracket plus d divided 2 multiplied b square square bracket cosinus bracket p minus theta divided to closed bracket minus 1 closed square bracket. Now from 4.5 we can put b equal d divided 2 tangens open bracket p minus theta divided 2 closed bracket. And after some manipulation obtained, r equals d divided 2 open square bracket plus 1 plus 1 divided cosinus bracket open bracket p minus theta divided 2 closed theta closed bracket closed square bracket, or r equals d divided 2 open square bracket 1 plus 1 divided sinus theta divided 2 closed square bracket. This result can be checked physically. Note that as theta tends to p corresponding to b equals 0 or a head-on collision, r tends to d, the distance of closed approach. Also as theta tends to 0 corresponding to the no deflection and all, both b and r go to the infinity as would. From 4.5 we see that the scattering of an alpha particle by a single nucleus is the impact parameter in the range b to b plus db. Then the scattering angle is in the range theta to theta plus d theta, where the relation between b and theta is given by the equation. This is illustrated in figure 4.5 figure. The problem of calculating the number and function of theta d theta of alpha particles scattered into the angular range theta to d theta plus d theta in the traversing the entire foil is therefore equivalent to the problem of calculating the number which are incident with impact parameter from b to b plus db upon the nuclei in the foil. As we show in the following example, the result is n function theta of the multiplied the theta equals open bracket 1 divided 4 multiplied p multiplied epsilon sub 0 closed bracket square open bracket z multiplied e square divided 2 multiplied m multiplied v square closed bracket square multiplied I multiplied rho multiplied t multiplied multiplied 2 multiplied p multiplied sinus theta multiplied the theta divided sinus 4 power theta divided 2, where I is the number of alpha particles incident on the foil of thickness t centimeter containing rho nuclei per cubic centimeter. Detailed experimental tests of 4.7 were performed within a few months of the derivation by Geiger and Martin with the following results. First, the angular dependence was tested using foils of Argentum and Aurum over the angular range 5 degrees to 150 degrees. Also, n function theta multiplied by theta varies by a factor of about 10 to 5 power over this range. The experimental data remained proportional to the theoretical angular distribution to within a few percent. Second, The quantity and function theta multiplied by theta was found indeed to be proportional to the thickness t of the foil for a range of about 10 in thickness for all the elements investigated. Third, equation 4.7 predicts that the number of the scattered alphas will be inversely proportional to the square of the kinetic energy, A multiplied with square divided 2. This was tested by using alpha particles from several different radioactive sources, and their predicted energy dependence was confirmed experimentally over an available energy variation of about a factor of 3. Fourth, finally, the equation predicts and function theta multiplied by theta to be proportional to z multiplied e square, the square of the nuclear charge. At the time z was not known for the various atoms. Assuming 4.7 to be valid, the experiment was used to determine z, and it was found that was equal to the chemical atomic number of the target atoms. This implied that the first atom, hydrogenium, in the periodic table contains one electron, the second atom, helium, contains two electrons, the third atom, lithium, contains three, etc., since that is also the number of electrons in the neutral atom. This result was soon independently confirmed by X-ray techniques that will be discussed later.